Have you ever heard somebody say, would you listen to me? Yeah? Honest man. I assure you, for everybody who says that, there are a lot of them who think it. As long as you can communicate with especially your mate or your son or daughter or brother, sister, or parents, there's hope. But when you dry up the communication or stop the communication, there is not much hope, if any. Communicating, especially in the home, is absolutely vital to the welfare of the continued good of the home. So tonight we will talk about it, listening to one another in the home. I'm going to start by talking about how you communicate effectively. I'm going to give you 9 considerations here about communicating effectively. And we're talking especially in a home environment. Number one, always tell the truth. Always tell the truth. When you start lying, people stop listening. They stop believing you. They may hear you, but they don't hear you. So to communicate better and effectively, you have to be honest about it. A character trait that ought to be in everyone, but it's not always in everybody. Ephesians chapter 4, and it is verse 15, which says, but speaking the truth in love may grow up into him in all things. Speak the truth, but do it gently. Do it in love. Do it where people realize you're not just putting them down or beating them up, but that you care. You really do have their welfare as well as the welfare of your home in order or in mind. Look at these scriptures in Proverbs chapter 12. Here's verse 17. Lying lips are an abomination to the Lord, but they that deal truly are his delight. Telling the truth. The Lord loves that, and he blesses those who do it. Listen to this. The lips of truth shall be established forever. And then also, he that speaketh truth showeth forth righteousness, but a false witness, deceit. God talking about how important it is, especially in this very intimate environment, which is the home, where you have husband, wife, children, parents. This is the place where, of all places, there ought to be transparency and honesty. It's the way to get it across. It's the way to be understood. It's the way to get your message across. Number 2 on this list, and I'm going to just run through it tonight, always speak in love and kindness, not only the truth, but as that 15th verse of chapter 4 in Ephesians says, do it in the right way. Proverbs chapter 15, verse 1, a soft answer turneth away wrath, but grievous words stir up anger. This lady, she's been my wife now for almost these 54 years. We get along most of the time and do it well. But I know how to pick a fight with her. And she knows how to pick a fight with me. And I have learned the hard way that it's better not to pick it. It's just better to keep getting along and doing things so that we don't go to war in our home. And one thing that'll pick a fight with her is a harsh, cutting answer. You know, and when you have the kind of personality that's kind of a perfectionist type mentality, it's pretty easy to be pretty hard on the people who are around you who you don't think have it. They are not doing the job the way it ought to be or as quick as it ought to be done and all of those good things. And it's pretty easy for your tongue to get sharp. And you say it and it comes across pretty hard. And I can tell when I'm doing that because her eyes double in size. All of a sudden, and I said, back up, brakes, back up. It's not a good thing I'm doing here. A soft answer has a lot of benefits, a lot of really practical benefits to it. Listen to Proverbs 25 and verse 15. By long forbearing is a prince persuaded, and a soft tongue breaketh the bone. I mentioned the other night, we were talking about discipline, how that My mother did it. She disciplined me, and she gave me some what I would call whippings or spankings that were pretty good. I mean, they were heavy duty. But I'll tell you that while she was doing it, she was weeping nearly every time. And this is hurting me. I hate it. You need to know. You know better than that. I mean, she was just, and I'm telling you, it wasn't just my rear end that was hurting. It was my heart. She was breaking my heart. It never made me happy that I broke her heart. And when I saw that I had, then it was a heartbreak to me. Do you hear that? By long forbearing is a prince persuaded, and a soft tongue breaketh the bone. Yeah, you can dress somebody down, and you can tell them off, and you can tell them what they did wrong, and you may be absolutely right. You may be accurate in what you're saying. It's not just what you say. It's how you say it. That also matters. We get real high and lofty on that haughty ground thinking, well, I just said the truth. I don't have to apologize for that. Well, yes, you ought to say the truth, but it's not enough to just speak the truth. That Ephesians passage says, speak the truth in love. That's Christian too. That's what ought to characterize every one of us, a gentle spirit. Yes, firm. Yes, saying what needs to be said, but saying it in the right way and saying it at the right time. Listen to Proverbs 16 and verse 24. Pleasant words are an honeycomb, sweet to the soul, and health to the bones. It is not my intent to talk about the bones per se tonight. I'll recommend a good book to you by Dr. S. I. Macmillan. The title of the book is None of These Diseases. It's probably out of print. It's an old book, but he was an eminent doctor, and he studied Israel from a medical standpoint and the diseases of Egypt and how they came upon or would come upon the Israelis, providing they did certain things that God forbid them to do. And in his book, he deals with the bones and particularly with bitterness. And when you get something in your craw, bitterness, it has a way of softening, literally softening your bones. When you have an adrenaline gland that's prompted to overreact, and bitterness does that, and stress does that, when your adrenaline gland gives off too much adrenaline into your system, it gets into the bones, so that people too early get arthritis and rickets and osteoporosis and other bone diseases, not realizing that they're reaping weak, soft bones because of decisions they made to hold grudges and to get mad and fly off the handle and have temper fits. Here's how the New Testament puts it in Hebrews in chapter 12, verse 15, looking diligently, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. Look at the natural three-point sermon that's right in that verse. A root of bitterness will spring up. That's quick action. Doesn't take long for a bad word or a bad deed to just hit you in the pit of your stomach. You feel resentment right off. Anger jumps to the surface out of like a jack-in-the-box. A root of bitterness will spring up, and it will trouble you. How will it trouble you? It'll trouble you in loss of sleep. It'll trouble you in soft bones. It'll trouble you in a whole lot of other ways, medically. And thereby many be defiled. It's like a little leaven. Leaven's a whole lump. You can't get mad and angry and carry a grudge without affecting your mate or your children or your parents. It's just corrosive and contagious. So that when we make a choice about unkindness and holding a grudge, we're hurting ourselves. And here's the Bible just saying it right here, that a soft tongue breaketh the bone. Listen to the New Testament, Colossians chapter 4 and verse 6. Let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that you may know how you ought to answer every man. The general idea of this verse is don't fly off the handle. Don't let your temper get hold of you. Some people will say, well, that's just the way I am. Nobody has to stay just the way they are. The grace of God is sufficient to change our approach to life, including dealing with our temper. And maybe we'll come back to that a moment later. But let me say number three, when you communicate, always have something to say. Now, you say, don't always. I've heard people talk for a long time, including a lot of preachers, and they didn't have much, if anything, to say. I was talking to Isaac back there today, and I said, when you get up to preach, Isaac, always have something to say. Don't just say something. Well, the reality is we ought to think about what we're going to say and have something to speak when we speak. Proverbs chapter 15 and verse 23 says, a man hath joy by the answer of his mouth, and a word spoken in due season, how good is it? It's good to have something to say that's of worth. A ratchet jaw, somebody that just goes on and on, a man or as far as that, a woman who just runs off at the mouth, as my brother used to say, who has diarrhea of the mouth, is like a continual dripping on a housetop, Solomon said. I mean, it just ought not to be for any of us, male or female. I mean, it's just, sometimes it's just good to shut your mouth and listen. And if you're going to say something, let it be of value. Let it be of worth. That's the idea in communicating here. It's not just to exchange words or say words. It's to have something of value to say. I'll turn your attention to this passage in the Proverbs. And it's chapter 17. Let me just read in your hearing verses 27 and 28. For he that hath knowledge spareth his words. Did you hear that? He that hath knowledge spareth his words. You know what we preachers say? Why use five words when you could use 5,000? Well, a lot of us do that. You don't have to be a preacher to do it. And a man of understanding is with excellent spirit. Yeah. Verse 28 says, even a fool, when he holdeth his peace, is counted wise, and he that shutteth his lips is esteemed a man of understanding. You've seen some people around, they kind of got a nice look, and they stand back and listen. You say, that's a wise old guy. He hadn't even opened his mouth, but you think he's a wise old guy. Well, the way we set it up in East Texas, it's better to be silent and be thought a fool than to open your mouth and remove all doubt. So this is kind of what the scripture I just read in your hearing is saying. We don't have to just talk. We need to have something to say. 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 11 says, if any man speak, let him speak as of the oracles of God. That's another reinforcement to just what I'm saying. Always, to communicate effectively, have something to say. Don't just open your mouth and run it off. Number four on this list, speak only when it will do good, only when it will help. I can't tell you how many times I have talked and spoken and realized it didn't do a bit of good. It'd have been a whole lot better if I'd just listened. This wasn't the time, it wasn't the place for me to do it. Speak only when it will do good. There are a bunch of these scriptures that are on this list. Proverbs 11 and verse 13, a talebearer revealeth secrets, but he that is of a faithful spirit concealeth the matter. I think that I can safely say this, brothers and sisters. I know enough on a number of people that I could put them in prison. I mean, I know some stuff that just curl your toenails. Now, there is a time when pastoral privilege doesn't apply, and that's with a child molester or some of those. So we are mandatory reporters, and we have to tell certain things. But there are a lot of other things that we don't have to tell. So why should I go around with a clothesline hanging out of my mouth with other people's dirty language on there and dirty laundry on there? It serves no purpose. That's exactly what this is talking about right here. If you want to talk to people and communicate, really get across. You understand them and they understand you. Solomon is saying here, don't be a tellbearer that just goes around telling things you know that have no value to them. Do it only when it will do some good. If you've been in a Baptist church very long, and I look around this room and I see most of you have, you got to know that if something very bad is done or something very bad is said in a Baptist church, by probably the next morning, by noon at the latest, it'll be around a pretty good many circles. We talk a whole lot about lying, and we get real pious about don't cheat on your mate and don't drink this alcohol, and somehow we have a very tender affection for gossip. You know, that's okay. I mean, don't do that other stuff, but it's okay to tell. Do you know what I heard? The Bible condemns it pretty strongly right here. You see that, can't you? Listen to Proverbs 12 and verse 23. A prudent man concealeth knowledge, but the heart of fools proclaim foolishness. What does God call people who are gossips and just tell it and spread stuff that have no value? He calls them fools. I mean, it's really God's idea. Look at verse 9 of chapter 17. He that covereth a transgression seeketh love, but he that repeateth the matter separateth chief friends. And if you read much in the Bible, you got to know that a divider of people is high on the things that God hates. He, according to Proverbs chapter 6, these six things that the Lord hate, yea, seven are an abomination to him, and one of them is a lying tongue, particularly when it separates people. It causes people to begin to turn from each other. And I can tell you that separating people has a tendency to grow and separate a church. And a whole lot of churches find themselves in trouble and in a split, growing toward a split, because somebody couldn't keep his or her mouth shut. There was Jerry Clowers, one of those guys, his funny little monologue some years ago. And I remember him talking, you know, he's like talking to God. And I remember one of his lines was, God, everything we say about our neighbors is true. Like, that makes it okay. No, it doesn't make it okay because it's true. Sometimes you don't need to say it. It has no value. You need to keep it to yourself. And pray for them and try to help them to get over that sort of thing. Listen here to Proverbs chapter 10, verses 20 and 21. The tongue of the just is as choice silver. The heart of the wicked is little worth. The lips of the righteous feed many, but fools die for lack of knowledge. He's talking about people who are talking about other people and spreading lies and rumors around and stuff that may be even true, but it don't need to be said, and he calls them fools right here. So I say number four there, speak only when it will do good. And let's look at number five, listen to and read your listener. Pay attention to your wife and her reaction, how she's taking to what you're saying. Pay attention to your husband and how he's looking and how he's reacting to what you're saying. You have to listen. Conversation is not telling somebody off or telling them something while you get the floor and they just listen. Conversation is a back and forth matter. It's a monologue or a rebuke or putting them down when you get the floor and you just say what you got to say. You need to give them an opportunity to say something too. It may or may not be true, but you can express yourself. You can talk about it. You can see where the rubs are. You have some grounds to work. You've diagnosed a problem, and you've gotten it out in the open, in a position to deal with it. John 16 and verse 12 said, Jesus doing the talking here, he said, I have yet many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. Here's Jesus Christ. He's got a whole New Testament to give. We have it here, 27 books. He's talking to his apostles, saved people, and he's saying to those great men, and I say the apostles were great men of God, you are not ready for what I have to say. I could tell it to you, but this is not the time. This is not the place. You're going to have to do a little growing before you're ready to receive some of the things that I'm going to give you that are going to be written in my word for people at Midway Baptist Church in Mckinney, Texas. It sure would be a growth for us to learn that, Christians, there's a time and a place to say things. And generally, a fit of anger, frustration, is not the time to say it. Many times our minds are addled and we're not seeing things the way we should, and Satan's kind of in charge of our mouths and our minds. And so we say things we wish we hadn't, and we regret it. And a whole lot of people have spent a whole lot of their lives wiping up spilled milk, regretting things, knowing they should not have said that. It was too hurtful. Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 2, I fed you with milk and not with meat, for hitherto you were not able to bear it, neither yet are you now able to bear it. So same idea of Jesus talking here, and he's talking to those Corinthians. And it's quite a message for you, and it's quite a message for me. Watch your student. Watch your wife. She's your student, your husband. He's kind of a student, I mean, in that position. Watch who you're talking to, you're communicating with, and read them. And sometimes it's the body language or what you know of their lives that tell you where the light is green to say something that needs to be said in a kind, godly, and Christian loving way, or whether this is just not the time, you just need to sit on it a little longer. Number 6, be patient with your listener. Boy, that is one of the harder ones. I told you so. You should have got it, you dumb head. No, you wouldn't say anything like that. I bet you've thought it or something similar to it. Well, we need to learn how to be patient. As God says to all of us in our lifestyle, particularly with our communication, we are to act with all lowliness and meekness, with long-suffering, forbearing one another in love. Forbearing. Being patient. People need time. We have to sometimes let some things soak in. I've heard some things said to me by some people that I love that at the moment I didn't like to hear it, and I wasn't going to hear it. But when I got off and thought about it, God began to convict me. I had to soften up and go back and say, yeah, she was right, or somebody that was trying to help me was right, and appreciate it. But it took a little while. Thank God for people who are patient. And aren't you grateful that God is patient with you? Man, if he had a hammer in heaven or a switch in heaven, and every time you did something wrong, he popped you right on the spot, you'd probably be in a grave somewhere right now. But praise him for his patience. And we are to be like him. We're to act like him. He shows grace to us. He tells us to show grace to the people in our lives. And that means being patient and giving people time. And then number 7 on this list is think before you speak. Man, if I asked for a show of hands tonight, I know I'd get a unanimous vote. If you've ever spoken before you thought. As we used to say in my part of the world, you need to put your mind in gear before you put the car in gear. I mean, put your mind in gear before you put the car in gear. We didn't say it exactly that way, but that's what we meant. I mean, don't get your mouth to working before your mind is working. Man, oh man. I found about myself, and don't look at me with two pious eyes, I can say things smarter and better and sharper when I'm a little mad than I can any other time in my life. I mean, when you get me a little riled, I tell you, I could tell you off big time, right in my heart. And I've done it. But I'm not happy about that. I'm not proud of that. It's sad that we get to talking and saying things, sometimes even harsh and cruel things, condemnatory things to the people, like a wife, children, parents, that we love the most, and we haven't really thought it through. And when we back off and do think it through, we realize how wrong it was. Maybe what we said was right. Maybe it wasn't, but maybe it was. But we shouldn't have said it. We should have thought it through. I'm simply saying communication, real communication, means thinking about it before you say it. And sometimes that means just biting your tongue, just closing and zipping your lips. Then number eight, don't get angry. And sometimes in communication, quite often in communication, we do. We get mad. You get to talking to somebody and they start pointing out your flaws and you said this and you did that and they don't seem reasonable to us and they get to saying hurtful things to us. And can't you just feel your temperature coming up? Can't you just feel yourself? I tell you, buddy, one thing, if you're talking to your mate and you're beginning to feel a little angry about it, both of you just get down on your knees and talk to God for a while and pray about it. Generally, when you get up, you'll feel, you won't be ready to be quite doing what you're doing. You'll calm down. Not always, but it's a good thing to do. And if you can't calm down right away, just make an agreement that you'll take it up tomorrow. Sleep on it for a night. Many times, that really does help to just back off, give both of you time to think it off or think it over. And number nine on this list is don't take your listener for granted. Don't assume because you tell somebody something that they got it, that they understood it. We do that very often. We assume you should know this. You should understand what I mean. They don't. Sometimes, yes, but a lot of times they don't know what you mean. They are in darkness about it. And you kind of got to explain it to them. And you got to do it in a gentle enough way so that they don't resist it. I have a graphic up here that I call silence is not always golden. We say that. You know, there's an old saying, silence is golden. Well, not always. For one thing, language is our means of explaining and forgiving. As I said earlier to start, you have to be able to talk about things. You have to explain yourself. You have to hear explanations. Don't you sometimes want to know why she said that or did that or he did that or said that? Yes, because that's where we work out our differences. Language is our means of saying I'm sorry and explaining our case and making our case and all of that. God said, come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. And though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. If God says, let's talk about it, let's reason about it, let's think about it, why shouldn't we? We're not better than God. We're not smarter than he is. Sure, he knows what it takes. God gave us languages. Do you know when many of the world's troubles started? That is, interpersonal relationships. You say, well, it all started in the third chapter of Genesis when sin came. Well, there was just Adam and Eve then. But there came a time when there were a lot of other people, and they were all working together to build a tower up to heaven, a sort of rebellion against God. How did God stop it? He confounded the language. It's called Babylon, or Babel, and Babylon comes from, means confounded language. What happened when they couldn't talk to each other anymore, when they couldn't reason? They started fighting within themselves, and that brought about the separation of the nations. That's where we have all these nations, the Frenchmen and the Germans and the people in South and North Africa and the people out in over in Japan. I mean, it didn't happen overnight, but that's when it started, as these clean gene pools began to separate, and then these breeding populations got in there, and some of them were called Frenchmen, some of them were called Afro-Americans or Negroids, and some of them were called by other names. But that's where it started. It started with the confounding of languages. It started when communication broke down. I'm telling you that silence is not always golden. In fact, it hardly ever is. When you lose your ability to talk, again, I repeat, you're going to lose a lot of other things with it. Furthermore, in silence, nothing is resolved. Sometimes people think because they don't deal with the issues, they just go away. They don't just go away. People remember. Husbands remember. Wives remember. And what they do, they bury them inside. And what is something buried inside that's not resolved? It's a grudge. And grudges have a way of growing. And after a while, a bunch of grudges and then trouble. So don't imagine that just because you overlook something and go on, that it solves the problem. We have to talk about them. We have to communicate to get these things resolved. Now, we're going to turn around and look at this the other way. I'm going to talk to you about 9 communication breakdowns. 9 communication breakdowns. Why don't people communicate? What is it that keeps them from getting together and resolving their conflicts, husbands and wives, that often end in divorce because they didn't do these things? Why do boys run away from home and girls run away from home? Here are some of the reasons. Number 1, failure to listen. Failure to listen. Hebrews chapter 5, verse 11, of whom we have many things to say unto you that are hard to be understood, seeing ye then are dull of hearing. Boy, that we don't often see as a rebuke to us, but it is. We are dull of hearing. I think most of us are not nearly as good at hearing as we think we are. I'm not talking about just the natural ears. I'm talking about the inner ears. Margaret says about one of our grandchildren that he has selective hearing. I think his grandpa has selective hearing sometimes too. And she didn't even say amen. Did you notice she passed her opportunity? I'm just telling you, brothers and sisters, all of us could do a better job of hearing. We ought to be doing it. We need to listen more than we're listening and hear what's being said. Well, why don't people listen? Well, I've listed some reasons here. One is the mind is already made up. Why don't I hear her, Margaret, talk to me more than I do? I think I already know. You don't have to tell me, I already know. Now you would, no, Brother Hutson, you wouldn't be that conceited. Well, I'd like to agree with you, but I have to admit that sometimes, you know, I get so involved with other things and I'm so tunnel visioned that I just don't think I need to listen. I'm not deliberately thinking that and saying, no, I don't want to hear her. I'm just busy. I just think, well, you know, if she said, I'm leaving you today, I'd listen. But somehow lesser things don't seem that important. And she doesn't threaten to leave me, I'm happy to say. So the mind already being made up is one. Listen to this proverb. It's chapter 1 and verse 5. A wise man will hear and will increase learning. A man of understanding shall attain unto wise counsel. A wise man listens. Wouldn't you like to be thought of God as a wise man? I would. I'd like to be, in his esteem, wise. James chapter 1 and verse 19. Let every man be swift to hear, and slow to speak, and slow to wrath. Well, why would we want to do it that way when we could be swift to speak and slow to hear? Isn't that the way we usually are? Yeah, I'll get my 2 bits in before anybody else. I'm just ready. I'm a quick answerer. Proverbs 15, verse 31 with 32, the ear that heareth the reproof of life abideth among the wise. He that refuseth instruction despiseth his own soul. Did you hear? He despises his own soul if you won't listen. But he that heareth getteth understanding. It's self-destructive to shut your ears and develop selective hearing and not pay attention, especially to a mate or to someone who's close, a friend who loves you and who's trying to help you to see a flaw so that you can get over the thing. But not me. I already know. My mind's made up. Another reason people don't listen is conceit. These 2 verses here, these 2 passages, Proverbs 30, verses 12 and 13, there is a generation that are pure in their own eyes. Do you think you know which generation he's talking about? Yeah, a generation that are pure in their own eyes and yet is not washed from their filthiness. There is a generation. Oh, how lofty are their eyes, and their eyelids are lifted up. I'd say that fits our current generation quite well. We know it all. Have you seen the explosion of selfies? Selfies? Somebody takes a camera, a phone, and reads out here, I would take a picture of pretty old me. I'm so great. You get in the picture with me and I'll... Selfies. We're lofty. We know it. We're beautiful. It's all about me. I think the Bible's talking about that right here in this place. And then Romans chapter 12 and verse 16. Be of the same mind one toward another. Mind not high things, but condescend to men of low estate. And be not wise in your own conceits. That's the advice of God. That's the advice about communicating. That's the advice about having a better marriage. That's about how to solve problems with your mate and in your family. Be humble. Talk to people about them. Talk to the people who you need to talk to. Another reason why people don't listen is they're thinking ahead. If you've been to many conversations, paid attention to what was going on, you've got to have seen this a lot of times. I've been talking to people, and you could just tell they just couldn't wait to jump back into the conversation. You ever seen that? I mean, their hands are moving and just waiting to jump into the conversation. And when they jump in, they're not even close to what you were talking about. They're way over here somewhere else. I mean, they're completely off. It is as clear as your nose in front of your eyes. They weren't listening to you. They were thinking ahead about what they were going to say, not about what you're going to say. And right in the same category is, I'll skip on down to number E here, butting in. Butting in. that just blows me away. You're talking to somebody, and some of them won't even let you finish what you're saying until they finish it for you, and they're not even in the ballpark. Would you just listen? Just let me finish. Hell, you're an honest man. Well, butting in, it breaks down listening, doesn't it? People are not doing it. They're just butting in and taking over the conversation. And that goes back really to D, holding the floor. I've known a few folks, if they ever got the floor, you could take a nap and wake up before they get through. I mean, they got it, boy. I mean, they're going to go on and on. And have you noticed how people can be talking and they'll say something, it'll remind them of something else, and then they go over here, and then in that conversation, it reminds them of something else, and first news you know, they've chased a rabbit from here to China. I mean, they're just out there, way out there. That's not conversation. That's not communicating. Communicating is back and forth. I'm hearing you, you're hearing me. We're dealing with real issues. We're staying on the track, and we're learning how to deal with our lives. And then we often forget that there's more than words involved. Failure to listen is sometimes because there's a body language going on. You know, if somebody's looking at me like this and saying, I love you, I'm having a hard time hearing them. I kind of got to believe that maybe there's more going on here than is being said. So failure to listen, there's also another breakdown, and it is lack of understanding by the listener. Remember, it's not only the person doing the talking, it's the person doing the hearing. Because it ought to be a two-way street, as I've been emphasizing here. Sometimes people don't even try to hear what the other one is saying. They're not really trying. For whatever reason, maybe some of those I just named there, but they're not trying. Psalm chapter 82 and verse 5 says, they know not, neither will they understand. They walk on in darkness. I bet you've talked to some people like that. You realize, I'm trying to help you, I'm trying to talk to you, but you just aren't paying attention. You're just walking on in your way, oblivious to what I'm saying. Chances are, if you've reared any children, you've come across that. You're talking to sometimes your kids, and, hey, why don't you listen to me? You know, I'm trying to help you, but they're on another wavelength out there somewhere, and they're not all there, but you got to do it anyway. I think my mother thought that about me. I really do. I mean, when I was a kid and I was working out there at that little country farm, and we were raising a truck patch and feeding cows and milking cows and taking care of chicken and eggs, and I mean, it was work, just work, work, work. And this was long before Margaret came along. But I had a girlfriend. I'm on thin ice, you understand. This girlfriend loved to ride horses. And she was real red-haired. And she'd, on our dirt road out there, and she'd get on that horse of hers and ride down that road. And I'm out here having to work in the garden with my mother. And it wasn't working well with me at all. I'm telling you, I was so upset. Mother, I want to go ride horses. And you got to finish this work, boy. And that work could take all day. And Mother would be just preaching to me and working me over, you know, boy, you need this and that. And I suspect that she thought I never heard a word she said. And I have to admit, I didn't hear enough. But I heard a lot of it. I heard more than she thought. I'm just talking about sometimes guys are like me. When she was telling me things, I wasn't even trying to hear her. In fact, I was trying to tune her out. I didn't want to hear it. It wasn't what I wanted to hear. That's not just true of little ornery going over Fool's Hill country boys like Lester Hutson was at that point in his life. That's true of parents. It's true of when the kids are trying to talk to them and tell them, Mom, Dad, let me tell you what's going on in my life. Mom and Dad don't want to hear it. Don't want to understand why. And let me give you a little reality gut check here. Your son, your daughter, they want to talk to you. And they need you to give them an ear. Not that you necessarily agree, but they want you to at least hear their case. But you keep cutting them off at the pass. And you do it again. You know what will happen? Your son, your daughter will quit talking to you. Oh, they'll talk small talk. But they'll quit talking to you about things that are really in their heart, where they really need some counsel. You say, well, why would that do? They ought to pay attention to me. Well, they probably would if you talk to them reasonable like they're somebody. And you got to keep in mind that children are just little people. They're not some robots or some other race. They're real people. And they got thoughts, and they need to be heard. And maybe they don't have that maturity you have, but there's where you got to keep the door of communication open. And if you shut it, then you wonder why you lost your kids. And I could tell you probably 100 personal cases that I have seen of where boys grew up and they were under dad's thumb and mom's authority until they got to a certain point and they left home and they quit going to church and they did their own thing for a while. I don't have to listen anymore. I will do. Never talking to dad for maybe the last 5 or 10 years before they got old enough to go. There's a way to remedy that. You can't necessarily guarantee that it won't happen, but you can cut down on the odds by making sure that you speak to them and that you listen. Not just them listening to you, but you listen to them. As I say here, one of the reasons is lack of understanding by the listener, and one of the reasons people don't understand is because they don't even try to understand. They've already decided, no need to talk about it. I'm not going to get through, so we won't even talk. I'm not even trying. I'm not going to pay attention. I just got to hear it. I'll just go on through here, right this, in this ear, out that ear, but that's the way it's going to be. Also, another reason why that happens is the speaker's not himself. Speaker's not himself. I'm sure you've spoken sometimes when you weren't yourself. As I've said already, maybe in anger, maybe hastily, when you were feeling bad, headache, some other thing like that. Psalm 39 and verse 1 said, I will take heed to my ways, that I sin not with my tongue. I will keep my mouth with a bridle while the wicked is before me. Just wait sometimes. Think it through. Calm down. Don't get too hasty, because sometimes the speaker is hasty, but sometimes you as a listener have to be big enough to understand, I got to calm down. Dad got a headache. You know, there's a problem here. And so I'm not going to be too offended. Man, there's been some times if Margaret had taken too much offense by what I said and what I said, how I said it, it'd have been a big war. But thank God, she's able to give me the benefit of the doubt that I was stressed out over something, and so she was willing to cut me a little slack. There's not a soul in this house tonight that doesn't need a little slack sometimes. You've said things, done things. You just need somebody to be a little bit patient with you, cut you a little slack. So another reason here why people misunderstand or don't understand is simply because they misunderstand what you're saying. They just, you think you're making it clear, but you're not making it so clear as you think. I mean, to you it's clear, but it's not clear to them. And has anybody here in the house tonight ever had a misunderstanding when you thought you were communicating, but you really weren't on the same page, you weren't on the same wavelength, and it wasn't ugly, intended to be bad, it's just that language is not an exact science. And so we have to bear that in mind when we're talking. And I will say that there are very few language experts among us. I'm certainly not one. I'm going to talk to you about another breakdown. A lack of care and concern for what is said. A lack of care and concern for what is said. One is truth without love. Standing on your high ground, I'm going to tell you the truth. I don't care how it affects you. I'm just going to say it. Proverbs 8 and verse 13 says, the fear of the Lord is to hate evil. Pride and arrogancy and the evil way and the froward mouth do I hate. That's God doing the talking here. Proverbs 4 and verse 24, put away from thee a froward mouth, perverse lips put from thee. Speak the truth, but back to Ephesians 4, do it in love. And then sometimes we're just careless with our words. We not only can be harsh, we're just downright careless. James chapter 3, verses 5 and 6 talk about the tongue, how it's a little member, but it kindles a lot of trouble. It's like a match that can kindle a forest fire and burn a whole forest down. A word bad or badly spoken can cause lots of grief in people's lives. I won't go in great length here to Proverbs, but maybe I should just take a moment to turn to the 8th chapter and read in your hearing verses 8 and 9. All the words of my mouth are in righteousness. There is nothing froward or perverse in them. They are all plain to him that understandeth, and right to them that find knowledge. Plain words, simple language. That's what the Bible's talking about here. Don't be careless with your language and just throw things around, because words go down into people's hearts and they remember things that were said, sometimes many years later. Then another reason why people do not communicate is hasty spoken words, too hasty to speak. We don't think it through. Effective words unweighed. This Proverbs chapter 5 and verses 1 and 2. Attend unto wisdom, and bow thine ear to understanding, that thou mayest regard discretion, and that thy lips may keep knowledge. Simply saying, weigh your words. Then sometimes the whole story is not known. There's a case that I've told before. It's just so simple, it seems to me. It's about the captain of the ship who had a first mate. The captain was austere, very demanding fella. His first mate was a young Christian man. He'd gone out to sea, his first mate. And they got into a certain port, and the first mate had liberty. He could get off the boat that night, so he took off with some other guys on the ship, and they went out. And these guys that were around him were old hardened sailors, and they took advantage of him, and they got him drunk. He didn't drink, but they got him drunk that night, and they brought him back. And boy, when they got him to the captain was just mad, and he gave him a real out, you know, reaming. And he wrote in the logbook, first mate drunk tonight. Man, the first mate, when he saw that the next day, everything, he pleaded with the captain, please, captain, don't say that. I mean, you know that's not reputation. It's the first time in my life, anything like that. Please don't wreck my reputation here. What I have written is written. Sometime later, it was the captain's opportunity to have shore leave, and the first mate was in charge. And while the captain was out, the first mate simply wrote in the logbook, captain sober tonight. Captain came back and said, you can't put that in there. What I've written, I've written. Let me tell you, folks, you need to hear the whole story. Sometimes you hear things and you think you got it all figured out, and you may not all have it figured out. I mean, it's just not what you think. Sometimes unsolicited opinions fall into this. I mean, have you ever had somebody say something to you that maybe was hurtful, It was just totally unsolicited. They just had to spurt off. It's kind of obvious that they had it on their heart and they just found a place and they dropped it in on you. Well, sometimes we're hasty to speak like that. And I won't go through these scriptures. We're running out of time. Study before answering. Always, don't be so hasty, but study. And all of these scriptures here are along those lines. I'll repeat that first one. Be swift to hear and slow to speak. This fifth breakdown is failure to tell the truth. Failure to tell the truth. It's one thing to speak outright lies, and sometimes people just flat out lie on other people and lie to other people. There, I imagine most of your kids have done that to you sometimes. There's a war going between your daughter and son, and they're one's 9 and one's 12, and one's saying, he did this, and she's saying, no, he did that. You're trying to figure, you kind of feel like Solomon. Bring me a sword. Let me divide this baby. You don't know what's the case because you realize they're one, somebody not telling the truth, and maybe both of them are. Well, people do that even when they get grown. They don't always tell the truth. Husbands and wives don't. Flattery, though, is another way of lying. Not just an outright lie, but sidestepping issues, half-truths, perversions. Heard about a guy who got promoted to the boss of his company. And some friend of his said, boss, you've heard the truth for the last time. People don't want to tell you the truth, so they'll veneer it. Let me tell you, it's a rare friend who will be honest with you about you. I was talking to Silas, I believe it was, the other night. Faithful are the wounds of a friend. Solomon said that. Sometimes the truth hurts you to the core. And most friends won't tell you because they think you'll be mad at them, you won't be their friend anymore, so they'll just tell you kind of, not a lie, but they won't tell you the truth. They just won't tell you what you need really to hear. I'm talking about breakdowns between husbands and wives, breakdown even between friends. And then there is this matter of talk without substance. We call it small talk. Just rattling tongue. The tongue of the wise useth knowledge aright, but the mouth of fools poureth out foolishness. You ever known anybody that just poured out foolishness? Seemed like it just had that ability to go on and on. Sometimes it's not just small talk. Sometimes people are downright wordy. You hear them talk, but it's hard to figure out really what they're saying because they're not doing the language very well. And number 7 is skepticism by the hearer. Skepticism by the hearer. Proverbs 14, verse 15, the simple believeth everything, but the prudent man looketh well to his going. Yeah, sometimes people, maybe they've heard you, they don't really trust you, so they just don't really believe you. Well, that's a communication breakdown. Also, anger at the truth. That's probably one of the easier ones. People get mad when you tell them the truth. They don't want to hear it. Just rather you just not really lay or come clean with them. And I could go through all of those verses there, but you can read them. And then assumed understanding. You assume that one knows what you mean. Listen, one does not know just because he's been told. I've been told things before, but it didn't register. It just didn't, somehow it just didn't get through. It just didn't, well, it's easy for us to say, you ought to know because I told you so. Just because you tell somebody so doesn't mean you've communicated with that somebody. You got to make sure they understand. And these rules or these ideas are along those lines. Now, I'm going to take these last just few moments. And I want you to look at the last page on your handout tonight. How listening in the home can mean the difference between disaster and victory. Sometimes I call this the victory road to criticism. I'd like to take a whole sermon on this right here. I have a chapter in a book that I've written, and it's called Don't Silence Your Critics. Don't silence your critics. That's the person most of the time we want to silence. Somebody that doesn't agree with us, doesn't like us, and says cruel things to us, offers some what we call destructive criticism, and we just like to shut them up. If we can't shut them up, we'd at least ignore them. So let's look at this little picture here, little graphic. And starting here at the top left, you see the man who is shot with an arrow of criticism. And those arrows usually come from somebody's tongue. It doesn't normally come straight to us. It comes via a grapevine. They say it to somebody else. Do you know what so-and-so said about you? So in one way or another, the critic reaches us. I mean, the idea, the criticism reaches us from the critic. There are two ways that we can immediately react. One of those ways is what I call the defeat option. That is, we simply ignore it. We don't pay any attention to it. You ever go to the mailbox and you get some junk snail mail? You know, it comes in and you see some things. You say, well, this is a vow pack, or this is some solicitor wanting me to buy a funeral plan or cremation plan or refinance my house. Or, you know, you get that stuff all the time. You know what the tendency is? File 13. On the way into the house, you just throw it in there. Never even looked to see there might be a check in there. Just might be. Probably not, but there could be something of value that you... But if you don't look, you will never know, will you? Somebody says something that's hurtful, maybe destructive to you, and you say, I'm not going to consider that. No substance to that. I'm not even going to give it the second thought. That is your defeat option. You will go to a doctor and pay big money to have your problem diagnosed. Somebody out there, a friend, or more likely an enemy, not in a constructive way, but in a destructive way, has looked you over and seen an attitude or seen a habit in you that is hurting you. It's offensive. And they're telling you for free what your problem is, and you're turning a deaf ear. Not even going to pay any attention. Not going to hear it. Not especially from that so-and-so. What a defeat option. How guilty we are of not even considering whether a thing is right or wrong. The victory option, as you can see, and these are always to the right, you will notice. Off to the left is the defeat. To the right is the victory option, and it is to consider its validity. At least you open the envelope and look inside and see if maybe there's something in there that's of value to you. You hear the criticism and think it over. Maybe, just maybe, there's some truth to what was said. Now, it's so hard to do, because the first thing you want to do is say, what does he have to say? For every fault I got, he's got 50. And he's trying to tell me, that hypocrite. At least listen. At least consider it. It may or may not be true. And if it's really not true, you can throw it away. But don't throw it away till you consider it. Maybe there's something to be said here. Then there's the devil again. He doesn't just try once. The devil is persistent. And the devil comes back when you think, well, I've looked it over and considered its validity. Well, then the devil gives you an immediate set of options again. And the one to the left of the defeat option is to reject it. Just don't really look seriously at it, but you reject it. It's like, yeah, that's a little true. It's like you're seeing a tree when somebody's trying to point out to you a forest. It's easy for us to minimize things. There's nothing big about that. Nothing really true. Your wife has told you, you are lazy. Maybe a little bit, but not near. Maybe she's really telling you that you are lazy. You need to pay attention. You really are lazy. You're a procrastinator. You know, the doorknob's been broke, or the mirror's been broke, or a light switch is, you know, something at the house, or for a long time, and you keep finding another way to go somewhere else and do something. You know, that's the defeat option. Don't minimize your trouble. A great many divorces have come along, and marriage issues, and sons leaving home, and daughters leaving home, and a strange relationship, because there was plenty of statement and criticism along the way to get the person's attention, they admitted there was a little substance, but they would never admit the reality and the gravity of where they were and where they're going. So they just kept going in the same direction and ended up way off defeated. If you accept reality, do not inflate, do not deflate. It's so hard. Just tell it like it is. See it for what it is. No bigger, no smaller, but admit where you are. Do your own due diligence about the problem that somebody probably has through criticism brought to your attention. And probably if you're getting criticism from one, you've gotten it from a bunch. I talked to a fella not too long ago who's had a whole lot of problems in one area of his life. And when we, the two of us, finally got an opportunity to sit down and visit, I began to talk about some things to him that were hurting and are hurting him. You know what the guy did? I said to him, I bet you've heard this at work, haven't you? Yes, sir. Didn't listen. Didn't pay attention. Not me. Not as big as this. You know what people do? They lose their jobs. They lose their wives. They lose their husbands. When they cannot get to this and accept reality for what it is. But if you accept the reality, the devil's waiting. You know, he's, as I said, persistent as the devil, because he is the devil. And the devil's always saying, well, you just need to quit. You need to give up. You can't fix that. You know what the big statement is for people here at this junction? That's just the way I am. They'll have to take me like I am. That is a cop-out. You don't have to stay like you are. That denies the grace of God. That denies all the scriptures about changing and being renewed to the Lord and being changed into His way. But people fall here. They start right here. I know I got a problem, but I'm just sorry. I'm too old to change. I'm too far down the road. The victory option is to determine to correct the problem. I see it. By the grace of God and the help of God, I'll fix that problem. Yeah, I don't have to stay in this ditch. I don't have to have this trouble in my home. I don't have to go to a divorce. None of this. I will deal with me. I will, by the help of God, solve the problems. I will take the criticism for what it's worth and use it to be a better husband, wife, dad, son, daughter, brother, sister. But if you decide that, the devil said, okay, big boy, you intend to do that. Yeah, that's good. You intend to do it. And somebody has well said that the road to hell is paved with good intentions. The road to improvement is paved with good intentions. Somebody who said, yeah, I'll do it, but never did it. No doubt at the judgment seat of Christ, there are going to be a lot of people said, yeah, Lord, I saw it, and I really intended to do something about it. I just died before I got around to it. The victory option is as obvious as this. The victory option is you don't just intend to do it. You take proper steps to do something about it. You get with the program. Take the steps. That's why James is such a key verse in my own life. Whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continueth therein, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work. You hear that? A doer, not just somebody intends to do it who helps to get around to it. A doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed. This is the guy whose marriage is improved. This is the guy who does better at work. This is the guy who's a better brother, a better sister, a better wife. The victory road of criticism. You're going in a bad direction. Somebody's brave enough to bring it to your attention. And you are honest enough to admit it. It's gravity. And determine in your heart to change to the glory of God. And you follow through. Father, thank you for this privilege to be here tonight. and to share these simple truths that I trust will be of real help in every home. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.